check, check. Ladies and gentlemen, we will be starting the show in just a few minutes. It's your last chance to grab a cocktail before the entertainment begins. Ladies and gentlemen, please direct your attention to the monitor, to the big screen in the front of the room.
Discount! Do you ever drink with men?
Yes.
Have you ever accepted a drink from a strange man?
Yes.
Those last two are gonna cost you.
Is there anything I can do?
Well, the Washington Post says married women get raped less.
So I'll get a husband!
Congratulations! Discount! Can I be a bridesmaid?
Of course!
Regressive, when the stigma is not enough. This message brought to you by LadyPartsJustice.com, kicking politicians out of vaginas since 2012. And now, the host of this evening's festivities, the co-founder of Lady Parts Justice, a feminist who has been hilariously kicking politicians out of vaginas since 2012, Madam Lizz Winstead!
Hello! Hi! Oh my God! Thank you all for coming. I can't even believe that we are here at the Feminist Sleeper Cell. in Brooklyn, because that's who we are. We are terrorists, of course. For all of our MRA friends who are watching, we want to destroy men. That is what we do. Feminism is about destroying men and never wanting to fuck them, which is why we're screaming for our rights to have birth control. So the logic is there. Welcome to Lady Parts Justice. We're pretty sure we're the only feminist, not safe for work, reproductive rights comedy website ever, pretty much. So you're part of it. Thank you for coming. Thank those of you at home who are actually streaming this, especially to our friends in Texas. At Whole Women's Health, we're going to be hearing from them later in the show. And to our friends in Louisiana who have rented a theater and who are streaming this whole thing live. So hi, down in New Orleans, yay. And all y'all who are out there. So there's a lot to talk about. I have a lot of business. I'm going to try to do it in a funny way, but there's so many people to thank and so many people who have made this thing happen. I'm just the loudest person. And take the mic a lot. I just seize things. But these people right here, oh, can we get the graphic up of the people? Maybe we'll go back to that. Our sponsors, I just want to thank first and foremost. There they are. I'm going to get out of the way. Yes. Bus Magazine has been a constant champion for women and for the work that we do for as long as I can remember. Babeland, an incredible... Yes. Superstore for all things pleasurable and all things educating yourselves to be pleasurable responsibly, which is always fun to be responsible and pleasurable. And when we're not, we want to be able to have options because, let's face it, we've all had that. Oh, my God! And that's just the way life is. If you have sex since the history of forever of people fucking, there's been a, oh, my God! And that's why we're here. So... Blue Nation Review, thank you so much. An amazing new information hub that is full of wonderful journalists, wonderful commentary. I happen to write there, Jimmy Williams and Company. Thank you so much for being here and for sponsoring. And last but not least, an organization I will be mentioning a lot tonight, Revolution Messaging. Yes, Scott Goodstein, Arun Chaudhry, who 2 years ago called me and said, we want to make a vagina video. Will you be the voice of it? And I said, weirdly, I want to make a vagina video. How about if I voice your vagina video and then you produce mine and then we see what happens? And so we did, and we put a video up on the web and it got 600,000 hits for no good reason. And we said, we should make lots of vagina videos and talk about reproductive health care in a whole new way. So Lady Parts Justice was born. About 3 months after that, my dear friend Sarah Sophie Flicker said, I want to be in the vagina business too. And I said, great. And cut to comedians, writers, musicians, activists, many who you will meet tonight, who have worked on trying to create an information hub that will grab the attention of women who are not paying attention. I think that a lot of people, even when they're pro-choice, they have no idea of the assault that's going on in all 50 states, and it is an assault. And I have been traveling around doing healthcare benefits for Planned Parenthood and independent clinics and for NARAL. And when I talk to clinicians and advocates and workers in all these states and you find out about these laws, you just realize that these people are sneaking in the dead of night. And we don't even know. It's not in the news. 31 states allow a rapist to sue for custody of a child. Yes! Exactly. Yes. I am not kidding. That is not the funny portion of the show. That is the factual portion of the show and of the website. So, yeah, you're going to learn facts. You're going to get them in a way through a pop culture lens. And hopefully you will all understand how important it is. It's a telethon. So donate at ladypartsjustice.com if you like what you see. Who else do we have to thank? You guys who are here, thank you. I want to thank Union Pool for hosting this event. You've been so great. It has been incredible to work with you guys. It's so easy. Get the Brooklyn beer. It's good to drink. We have sponsors. People gave so many prizes. I'll get to those in a minute. I wish you could all bid on the prizes. You can't. That's what happens when you're here. You get prizes. But we have bags of vibrators for people who come. It's so awesome. I know. Linda Carbone and your staff who helped us, publicists, thank you from the bottom of my heart. You have been so kind and generous with your time. And I'll stop with the lecturing because we have a show and I will thank the rest of you later. So the first thing we're going to do is throughout the night, we're going to monitor what happens with our live stream. We're going to see if any of our trolls show up because it's always fun to showcase a troll. People often ask me why I showcase trolls. And I say because for one simple reason, when we vote, a troll has the same amount of votes as you do. And so every time some freak is like, you know, why should I pay for your birth control? And I'm like, well, because I'd pay any amount for yours. You know that that... stay with me. You know that that person is going to the polls, same as you. So we want to make sure that every time there's a troll, I like to just... it's a public service, really. So Babeland, come on up. The Babeland vulva is going to join us. Oh yeah, can you come? Oh God, my God. Hi, Claire. This is Claire, the Babeland vulva. I love that you're, first of all, there's an all access pass on the Babeland vulva, which is kind of crazy and creepy, and ask permission, even though the vulva says all access, there is negotiations. You can't just enter the vulva. That's wrong. That's a lot of those things. We also have, yeah. Okay, so Claire, I just want to just quickly, before we kick off the show, thank you very much, because Claire is Babeland. And Pamela Doan, who has been a great advocate for Babeland, and they have been partnering with many projects that I do, and I just want to thank you and have you say some lovely things about Babeland so people know why you decided to come and be part of the Lady Parts Justice extravaganza.
All right. Well, I'm only one of, you know, two people that started Babeland. My partner Rachel is not here. But, you know, many, many hundreds of people have been part of Babeland for 20 years. We have been supporting female pleasure and the pleasure of men who enjoy female pleasure for 20 years. And in this climate where, you know, it seems like if, like, you're gay and you want to get married and your sexuality can be erased, that's fine. But if you want to have sex and you might have, you know, some sort of reproductive incident... yeah, if you might have some pleasure and need some birth control or some, you know, after services, you're out of luck. It's really time to get serious about this stuff. And I appreciate that Lizz Winstead is hilarious, number one, organized, number two, and, you know, relentless, number three, about this issue. And we will be with her to the end. Babeland vibrators.
Oh, my God. Babeland vibrators till the end. I know. Okay, so the Babeland vulva will be coming up throughout the evening, giving us updates, totals, and the troll report. So instead of me blabbing any further, I want to kick this off with a woman who has been with us since the beginning of our creative meetings last January. I did a show at the Creek in the Cave, and Leah was one of those people, and she started coming to the meetings and has been relentless. She is an incredible woman. You will see many of her performances on our videos on the website, and she is here live for you tonight. She's a woman who is a staunch feminist. She is a woman who travels to Iraq and Afghanistan and all throughout the Middle East to entertain the troops, and she is one of the funniest women I know. Please welcome one of the sleeper cell Lady Parts Justice Leaguers, Leah Benima!
Round of applause for Lizz Winstead, everybody. Let her hear it. Let her hear it. Oh, I am so incredibly grateful to Lizz and to Lady Parts Justice, and I'm so thrilled and honored to be here with you all tonight. It's very exciting to be standing up for Lady Parts Justice. I recently performed on a benefit to help raise awareness because pharmacies were privatizing and then not giving out women's birth control pills. And the man who was in charge of these shenanigans released a statement that said, "Birth control pills are miniature abortions, and we're taking a moral stand." A, I don't know where this pharmacist went to science school, but that's not how birth control pills work. And B, how about you take it down a notch, buddy? Right? I am so tired of all this emotional language being used to cloud issues. Like, what's next? How far are they going to take it? Is he going to try to outlaw pulling out? And I could actually see it happening. They'd be like, this just in from Fox and Friends. 1,000 babies died today on a young girl's stomach. It was a belly button holocaust. It's right here. I hate 50 Shades of Grey. I'll put that out there. I haven't read it. But that doesn't mean I'm not going to judge it. I'm an American. I do not need facts to have opinions about things. But I have friends who are obsessed with it. And the more they talk about it, the more I hate it. Like, my one friend keeps calling it a modern romance for women. And when I asked her what makes it a modern romance, she said, oh, there's this rich guy. Which, right? That's not any kind of romance. That's her having a fantasy about not getting a job. I thought we wanted equal pay, not to be Cinderella with a ball gag. And also, is the biggest quality of our ideal mate that they're wealthy? I think we could do better than that. Like, my ideal is Gandalf. Right? What a hottie. Because in Two Towers, he says, you know what? I'll be back in 5 days. Look to the dawn at east. And when does he show up? 5 fucking days later at dawn from the east. They're like, that's a man. Showed up when he said he was gonna. Right? I'll fuck a dude with a pointy hat and a staff for reliability. That's my romance. And apparently, the woman who's the main character in 50 Shades starts off as a virgin, which that's great. I'm cool. I support the choices. But she's a virgin in the United States of America in her 20s. So already I find our premise suspicious. Then our virgin meets this rich guy. Right away, they have sex. And then the first time she has sex in her entire life with a man that she barely knows, that she has no emotional connection with, she has an orgasm. I was like, oh, it's a science fiction novel. Like, I love sci-fi. Are there Vulcans in it? Is Spock gonna show up? Like, what are you talking about right now? What does that do but make men and women feel bad or inadequate about their own first-time experiences? Why can't we have an honest losing your virginity dialogue? Call it 50 Shades of a Panic Attack. Right? And then just write an entire chapter dedicated to the thoughts that go through a woman's mind the first time you have sex. I think that chapter would start with a girl being like, excuse me, what is that noise? It sounds like we're walking in a mud puddle. Is that? Oh, it's like a slapping? It's like fat slapping? I don't want to listen to my fat slap. Why does it feel like my organs are being moved? Are my organs being moved right now? I think his dick is in my kidney. Is it possible that his dick is in my kidney? You know what? I don't think I can ask that. That seems rude. You know what? I'll just Google it. I'm going to Google it later. Well, would I Google dick kidney or there's a kidney in my dick? I'm not sure. Oh my God, is there a fart button in there? Because it feels like he's pushing on a fart button. Am I going to fart during this? You know what? If I have to fart, I'm just going to cough. I'll just cough right over it. That's my plan on that one. Is that a pee feeling? Because I don't know if people pee. Could he pee? Could he pee? Because I think that's the same hole. Isn't it the same hole? Was I supposed to ask first? Is that a thing people do prior to sex? Like a road trip where you're like, make sure you pee before you get in. Oh my God, I just looked down and I cannot believe I shaved my pubic hair into the shape of a lightning bolt. I can't believe I did that. I thought he likes Harry Potter. It's magical. Where's the fucking magic? Oh my God, why did I just start thinking about my mom right now? I really hate eye contact. I'm just going to look this way. You know what? I'm better at this angle. I'm going to suck in and look over here. I think I'm farting. It's really happening. I'm just going to clench it. Is he stopping? Did he stop? What? Oh, that was it. That was great. Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm Leah Bonema, Lady Parts Justice Leaguer.
Yeah. just mixing up the medicine. I'm on the pavement, wondering where the clinics went. Looking for exam rooms, probing, freaked out. CPC's created out, lying what it's all about. Look out, kid, it's up you did. God knows when I'll be on top of the game. You'll be ducking down the alleyway, looking for a real friend. For now, the man in Harrisburg will fuck you with a big hand. Make you wait 11 days, but you only got 10.
Hey, Pennsylvania, you all know a back alley is no place for your reproductive health. What are you going to do about it? Join the fight at LadyPartsJustice.com. This message brought to you by LadyPartsJustice.com, kicking politicians out of vaginas since 2012.
That was me singing as Bob Dylan. How'd I do? And then I tried other things later, and then I got cocky, really bad. I do other really bad things. I go, who can't? And we're from Minnesota. So anyway, sometimes you get very lucky to have people in your life who are incredibly talented to the point where they kind of get annoying about it. Because they just make things that are great, and everything they fucking do is great. And it's like, really? And so then you go, I need to introduce you. What do you want me to say? And it's like, oh, you do everything. So I'm just going to pare it down a little bit. Since 1997, Jean Grey has been making music. Since October 2013, she's made 6 records and a book and an audiobook. She, her web series, have you seen her web series, Life with Jeannie? If you have not, it is fucking hilarious. She like packages the whole thing. She's the writer, the producer, the director, the whole thing. It's really great. Go and watch it. It's awesome. She's also hilarious. She's a producer, a teller of jokes. She is just has too much to mention. I'm going to get off so that she can come on. Please welcome the incomparable Jean Grey.
Oh, yeah, move the fuck forward. That's, yeah, no, everybody. Yeah, come on. Hi. How's everybody doing? Good. Yesterday I started my whole thing of not drinking for 10 days. Since I've been here, I've had 2 vodka tonics and a champagne. But I did want to talk about something more serious just before we start. The first real serious thing for me, and it started yesterday, and it's just a really hard thing to talk about in public in front of everyone. Black hair in the rain. A couple of us have been discussing this back there. I don't know if you know how horrible and difficult this is. I did not plan to come out tonight looking like one of the DeBarges. Nor either Turbo or Ozone from Breaking 2 Electric Boogaloo. But that's what's happening. So I thank you. Very hearty laugh going over there at my hair misery. Thank you. It makes it real difficult because the bathroom is actually, it's in the next part of this building. And I know a lot of you went to the bathroom with wild abandon, with no thought of how it would affect you. It took about 10 minutes for me to decide to go, as well as a couple of friends in here. So just to let you know that serious, serious issues. You can move in even closer. Not you on the chair, just move around her. What are you, shy? What's your deal? I know you. When Liz asked me to come and read something, I was super, super excited about it. And I was like, you know what, I kind of want to read my own thing. And I thought about doing it to the music, and I was like, meh, I like to be interactive with crowds, and I think this would be kind of a cool thing where we could all do this together. And then I thought about possibly some of you might be rhythmically challenged, but we're going to do it anyway. About 10 years ago, I recorded an album with a good friend of mine named Ninth Wonder, and the album was called Genius. On this album, I was in my 20s and kind of really coming to adult grips with a lot of things and who I was going to be and who I wanted to be and things I wanted to talk about. So it was the first time I'd ever discussed my teen issues, and this was one of the songs that kind of put the album over the edge for me. It's called My Story. What we're going to do, though, is I'm going to have you guys do the beat for it. Oh, fuck. So if you got your hands and you can clap, it's kind of a slow... Okay, we're not done yet. Slow down a little bit. Oh, shit. You're going to have to keep that going, so good luck. All right. Now we're going to add something. I'm not concerned. You're going to go... La, 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 la. La, 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 la. Sing it. La, 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 la. La, la, la. Slow it down a little bit. La, 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 la. With authority. Keep it going. If I could swim 1,000 lakes to bring your life back, I write that, but infinity can't rewind facts. You are divinity. Primitive mind was struggling just to understand the meaning of life. I never told my mommy I couldn't break her spirit. Always wished her daughter extraordinary thinking. So I traveled alone, young, 16. Got in the habit of not staying at home, doing a sad walk like Bill Bixby. $1.50 trip to the hospital so Medicaid could fix me. I couldn't eat shit. I fainted frequent. On cold floors, I pause and I think, keep it. I'm lost, my four friends know. And just fuck up the boy's apartment for rent. So I'm wishing it's a dream ending soon. I've actually erased a lot. Now when the rain comes down, I know it's falling for me, and only for me. And when that pain comes around, nowhere else I'd rather it be. I know what I've done. See, when the rain comes down, I know it's falling for me, and only for me. And when that pain comes around, nowhere else I'd rather would be. Keep going. Now all my bitter homies saying that's what men do. Feeling retarded for seeing partner potential. On top of that, the doctor's telling me a heart murmur. I can't take it. I'm contemplating a Glock burner or a cop murderer. I can't be. This can't be. The tears streaming and I can't see. They lance me and I'm passing out. And this is just for blood. They had to cover it in mass amounts. I've had enough. And you don't know what it's like in waiting rooms outside. Their picketing pictures can slay you. The screaming victims spitting till they shame you. I hold my head low and shiver, push my way through. They put you in a room where you can change into your gown or shower cap shaking as a fiend would do. That's when you think of lean, fleeing the building. Then they call you when you're hearing the call of your children. The countdown from 10 now. You want to stop it, but you say it in your head. You're out from the cut. Then you wake up in a room with plenty others. They call it recovery. You're thinking it ain't mothers. Prescription pills, written in a script with chills. Understatement, you're dressed, but you're naked still. And your brain won't think straight. Keep singing, come on. See you when the rain comes down. I know it's falling for me, and only for me. And when that pain comes around, nowhere else I'd rather would be. I know what I've done. See when the rain comes down, I know it's falling for me, and only for me. And when that pain comes around, nowhere else I'd rather would be. Change it to snaps and sing quieter. La 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 la. No snaps. fucking awesome. Give yourselves a hand. Thank you for having me. It's going to be a great evening. It already is. Lizz, you're awesome. My name is Jean Grey. I'm out.
Jean Grey. This needs to come down, sir. And now, a video from this screen, because we're multimedia.
I just want to go someplace with awesome national parks.
I just want to go somewhere where people can't park a probe in my...
Welcome to the Ultraviolet Board of Tourism. Let's set you up with the perfect vacation spot. Now, what's your criteria?
Someplace that isn't turning the clock back on women. And nowhere near his family in Michigan.
Hello, I'm right here.
I'm sure they are lovely people, sir, but I'm afraid Michigan has taken the unusual step of requiring women to carry rape insurance.
I'm sorry.
What?
Yep. In Michigan, a new law requires women to get extra health insurance, just in case she gets raped and needs abortion care.
I'm right here.
Okay. So where can we go where this lady stuff is a little less creepy? Music City, Nashville.
That might be okay, as long as you aren't pregnant. Are you planning on traveling while pregnant? Okay, good. Because if you're pregnant in Tennessee and you miscarry or anything goes wrong, the state can now legally poke around to see if you caused it, then toss you in jail.
I won't do well in jail.
You won't be in jail.
Huh. Oh, good. So, what about someplace like, Wisconsin? Go Badgers!
Nope. They have become probe happy up in those parts. Pardon my pun.
Ah, there's gotta be a place in America that isn't a repro rights hellhole. What about New Hampshire? Live free or die and all that?
That free thing is sort of yesterday.
The Lone Star State.
More like the Lone Clinic State.
Anywhere at all?
Well, according to your vacation criteria, the only option is Oregon! The one state that hasn't ever passed a single anti-choice law since Roe versus Wade.
Oregon, huh? Sounds nice. Crocheted condoms.
Artisanal lube.
I don't know about any of that. You will be happy that Oregon prioritizes access to women's health care and ensures privacy between a woman and her doctor.
Wow, all those rights.
Or maybe they make them out of hemp out there.
This public service announcement is brought to you by the Ultraviolet Board of Tourism, protecting women everywhere. To learn more and fight back against the creepy laws in your state, visit LadyPartsJustice.com and WeAreUltraviolet.org. Oh, and never use crocheted condoms.
All right, this is... I'm going to keep going. All right, this is from Amanda in Ohio. There we go. This is from Amanda in Ohio. On Tuesday, November 5th, 2013, I visited the hospital for a routine midway ultrasound. I was just over 18 weeks pregnant and excited to see my child. The tech took all the appropriate measurements and left the room to share the photographs with the doctor while my husband and I waited patiently. The doctor opened the door and informed us that our baby was very, very sick. Our son, whom we'd named Luca, was diagnosed with anencephaly, a lethal neural tube defect. We were devastated. That night, our midwife visited our home to discuss our options and talk the matter over with us. We decided that in the interest of my health and of our son's, terminating the pregnancy was the best option. Carrying to term carries its own risks to the mother, and having had complications in my last pregnancy, as well as two small children to care for, and knowing that we did eventually want to try again for a third child, and did not want to have a cesarean and increase my risk for complications down the road, termination, we decided, was the safest route. In addition to knowing that our son would most likely not live through the birth, emotionally, I knew I could not carry this child to term, or however long the pregnancy would last, and be stable emotionally. The next day, we met with the OB who would perform my surgery, and we were given the typical rundown as mandated by the state of Ohio. It was then that I learned that if I lived in a different state, one with more strict regulations on abortion, my situation could be very different. Our world was falling apart. And while I'm scared for Ohio's future law, changes and restrictions, I'm relieved we didn't have to factor in one more layer of legalities. I'm thankful for the OB who attended to me and treated me compassionately and with care, and for my midwife who counseled my husband and I and continued to check in on us after the procedure. Some may look at my situation as different than what is normally associated with someone wishing to terminate a pregnancy, but it's not. I'm thankful every day that I had a choice and could do so in a safe environment supported by my family, my care providers, and the hospital.
I was 16 years old, living in Las Vegas with my Mormon father. I told him I had a stomach bug and that I needed to go to the doctor. Thankfully, he ignored me, and I got to the doctor the next week during a visit to my mother in Virginia. That's when I found out I was pregnant. There was no doubt in my mind that I wanted an abortion. I was still in high school, and my father was 9 years my senior. And the father was 9 years my senior. It was not her father. Just to make that clear. Sorry. He was such a loser that he couldn't even get the $250 together for the procedure. But my parents hated him, so of course I thought he was awesome. Even so, my mother took me to a Waffle House for coffee and went through my options with me. She offered to let me move in with her. She offered to raise the child as her own, even. I'm 35 years old now, and I look back on that offer, realizing how incredibly amazing my mother really is. But I was certain I wanted to have an abortion. I wanted to finish high school, go to college, and stabilize myself. Also, I took care of my three younger siblings at a young age and had decided parenthood was not for me. My mother put me on the plane back to Las Vegas with a check in my pocket for my abortion. I went home to schedule it, just like Donna in Obvious Child. I knew that day I conceived, and I was exactly 6 weeks along on Valentine's Day. I scheduled my procedure for February the 16th instead. It was 19 years ago, but there are a few things I remember. I remember seeing a glass jar in the room and wondering if that's where my fetus was going to go. I remember the doctor patting me on the leg and saying something like, "We're going to get the old girl back again." I don't remember exactly what he said, but I know he definitely used the phrase "old girl" to describe either me or my 16-year-old uterus. He probably thought he was being comforting, but instead, it was just odd. My girlfriend went to the same clinic and said he said the same thing to her. Weird. The next thing I remember is waking up alone. I never told my father. There were no parental consent laws or waiting periods in Nevada. I never had children and do not regret it for a moment. I have an MBA, a great career with FedEx in Memphis, a husband, three beautiful dogs, and a thriving garden. My life is full.
Barbara, Indiana. In 1988, I was 3 months away from turning 18 when I learned I was pregnant. I had tried to be careful, but the condom slipped off my inexperienced boyfriend. I kind of knew at that moment I was in trouble. A few weeks later, I realized I needed to get a pregnancy test. I don't remember why I didn't just go to a store and buy a test. I guess I just wanted someone to help me. Being young and naive, I went to the first place I found that offered free pregnancy tests. Huge mistake. The first question I was asked was, what did I plan to do if the test was positive? I was still under the impression that these people were going to help me, so I said very bluntly, "I'll get an abortion." They asked why, and I remember saying that I didn't think anyone still in high school had the right to have a child. 17-year-old me had a harsh ideology, while I now think any woman of any age can have a baby if that's what she chooses. I also still think that not wanting to be a burden on society is a damn good reason to get an abortion. That sent the two elderly ladies into a tizzy. I spent the next hour listening to them explain how my fetus was a child, how they could help me get a crib and a baby and baby clothes, how they would even call my parents to tell them if I was too afraid. They showed me lots of photographs of late-stage fetuses, practically newborns. I got the hint pretty quickly that I needed to have a change of heart or these ladies were going to hold me hostage. So I did. I looked those old ladies in the eye and pretended to suddenly believe what they were saying. Then I peed in a cup, and they told me to come back in the next morning for the result. So the next morning I went, when I found out I was pregnant, the first thing I said to my friend when we got in her car, I'm going to die. Melodramatic, yes, but I was absolutely terrified of telling my parents. I had been held to a pretty high standards, and our sex talks had consisted of, don't do it. That shame was a big part of my reasoning. And I had envisioned a life of food stamps and government assistance, but I also was about to graduate from high school. I had already been accepted to college, and I was up for a half-tuition scholarship. My life was just beginning. That's not to say it was an easy choice. I remember feeling so defeated then, even worse when my girlfriends and I figured out that Indiana law at the time required parental consent for a minor to get an abortion. Kentucky was the only option. It seemed impossible. I went to the bathroom and sobbed with the realization that suicide was my only real option. I had a moment there where I accepted my fate. I was going to go home and take my life. That was the only choice I felt I had. Luckily, my friends forced me out of the bathroom and told me they would drive me to Kentucky, and we would all figure it out. They would make it happen. The four of us carried out our plan. We managed to make the four-hour drive to Louisville without any of our parents knowing. I was so nervous. We had to walk past several protesters to get to the building where the abortions were performed. I hadn't expected that. One of my friends was carrying my bag, so the protesters assumed she was the patient, and they directed their biblical quotes and hateful words toward her. I was so grateful to avoid that. It wouldn't have made me change my mind, but it would have made an awful situation so much worse. 26 years later, I still remember things about the other woman in the waiting room told me. I told the lady who was up before me that I was so nervous but surprised that I wasn't crying. She reached out and squeezed my hand and said, I won't let you cry. Such a small gesture of compassion, but it made me feel stronger and supported. I'd like to think my abortion brought about positive changes in my life. I was depressed most of the time during my last few months of high school. I think that stemmed from not being able to talk about it. I especially wanted to tell my mother, but ultimately I always came back to my original thought that it would devastate her. I knew that I had to be more careful and really get my shit together. I met my husband at college almost exactly 1 year later. We were so careful that there were never any pregnancy scares during our 7 years of dating, and we didn't have our daughter until we had been married for 12 years. Before I was pregnant with my daughter, I had a miscarriage. That was one of the hardest things I ever been through. It kind of made me feel like the universe was settling a score with me. However, I believe that a woman's body often naturally aborts a fetus when something is wrong. In the case of a woman with an unwanted pregnancy, I think that's also the case. Her brain, which is part of her body, tells her to get an abortion. In that sense, the body really does have a way of shutting that whole process down. And people who try to use religion in this argument frustrate me to no end. When I miscarried, people said, God has a plan. But when I chose an abortion, it was my sin. I'm agnostic because I think there is a God, but he does have a plan for each of us. Then he, she, it knew that I would choose to abort at 17. That was part of my life's journey. And I'm grateful for the lessons I've learned through the choice that every woman should have.
I got pregnant the first time I ever had sex. Call it luck of the draw. Actually, call it luck of the withdraw. I was brought up Catholic. I made deals with God. I made deals with myself. I thought, if I have sex and use birth control, I'll be committing two sins. If I just have sex, I'll be committing one. So because I'm a thinker, I picked the more fun sin. So when I found out I was pregnant, I went to my very sensitive hockey player boyfriend, and he responded the same way every 17-year-old boy with a mullet does. What the fuck? I thought you were on something. I foolishly said, I was on you. I had nowhere to go. I had nowhere to turn. I got on the bus, and I ended up at a crisis pregnancy center. And when you go into those places, you see a person who comes out wearing a lab coat, and you think, oh, a doctor. And then you realize that anybody at the Lancome counter also wears a lab coat, and that she was not a doctor. She ran my test, and in a minute and a half came out and said, we have the results, and we have pictures of your baby. And I was like, pictures from my pee? I mean, I... So she pulls out that picture. There's that one picture. I think that they only one time took a picture of a terrible, scary fetus. And I was like, that is inside of me? And she turned the next page of the book, and there was a picture of a six-year-old kid on a bike. And I was like, at what phase does that happen? And then I started to get freaked out because this was an adult. I was 16. I had rationalized my way into thinking I wasn't going to get pregnant. I was rationalizing my way into praying to God that I wouldn't get pregnant. I ended up at a place and I was pregnant. And I wanted answers from an adult. And she was clearly not going to give them to me. And when I said, what are my options? She said, your options are mommy or murder. And I remember walking out that day thinking, I am dumb enough to be here. I am not smart enough to be a parent. But the worst thing of all was that a woman standing before a 16-year-old girl was impersonating a physician and a person of God. And she looked at me square in the face and said, your life is insignificant. And while claiming she was pro-life, I would argue that she was profane. Hi, Holly.
What's going on? You look a little sad.
Holly, I'm just exhausted by all these politicians who keep screwing with our rights.
I definitely feel you there. Do you want me to play you a little song that might cheer you up?
Anything from you.
All right. Why are there so many vaginal problems? Why are they trolling my home? It's not based in science.
It's not in the Bible.
It's all about shame and control. They think our role is to breed just like cattle. Well, listen up if you disagree. Sign up and join us at Lady Parts Justice, the women, the allies, and me. That was beautiful, Eunice.
Holly, I feel so much better.
Aw, me too.
Let's go kick some douchebags out of office.
Let's do it. Can I give you a little kiss?
Yes, please.
This message brought to you by LadyPartsJustice.com, kicking politicians out of vaginas since 2012.
Buddy?
Is this thing on?
Hello? How are you?
Are you guys okay? Holy crow.
Oh my god. I'm gonna sing some songs.
You okay? Tighten that up. Can you tighten that?
You got it.
You got this?
Yeah.
Are you guys having a good time? You look good. You look nice.
This is my friend Holly Miranda. I'm Ambrosia Parsley. Can you turn this mic up just a little bit? Because just a little. Are you hearing yours?
Yeah.
Yours is really loud and mine's not. Do you like Holly better? Hello? Okay.
Are you ready?
Yes. Fine.
If you want a lover, I'll do anything you ask me to. And if you want another kind of love, I'll wear a mask for you. And if you want a partner, take my hand. If you want to strike me down in anger, here I stand.
Wait, I can't lower this.
Yeah.
I tried. I did try. I can go pretty low, but not like that. Can we try this again?
If you want a lover, I'll do anything you ask me to. And if you want another kind of love, I'll wear a mask for you. If you want a partner, take my hand. If you want to strike me down in anger, here I stand. I'm your man. If you want a boxer, I will step into the ring for you. If you want a doctor, I'll examine every inch of you. If you want a driver, I'm inside. If you only want to take me for a ride, you know you can. I'm your man. Oh, the moon's too bright, the chain's too tight, the beast won't go to sleep. I've been running through these promises to you that I made, but I just can't keep. Oh, but a man never got a woman back, not by begging on his knees. So I call to you, baby, I fall at your feet. I'll let your beauty like a dog in heat. I'd guard your heart, I'd tear your sheet, I'd say please.
And if you only walk the street alone, I'll disappear for you. If you want a father for your child,
for your child.
If you only want to walk with me a while, across the sand,
the sand.
I'm your man.
Stay. I didn't get a chance to introduce them. Ambrosia Parsley. Fun facts about both of them. Ambrosia has a record coming out this fall. She has a chronic stigmata condition. And she was the woman who sang the news on Air America Radio every Friday on the Lizz Winstead Rachel Maddow radio program. Woo! The lovely Holly Miranda also has a record coming out this fall. Reacts violently to chamomile tea. And lost her virginity in a Plymouth Fury. These two women have been involved in this and anything I have done for reproductive justice since the beginning of me doing it. And so I just want to say a special thanks to the both of you. I love you so much. Thank you, guys. Make out. Quick grabbing my ass, Holly Miranda. Yes. Now we're going to talk to the vulva. Let's bring the vulva up. Just real quick. We're just gonna get a little troll update, see if anybody's made any donations, you know, that kind of thing. Maybe people made donations online. You can make donations online. Did I mention that at LadyPartsJustice.com where you're watching this very thing?
Hi.
Hi, look, it's the vulva.
Hi.
Oh my god.
Hi.
Hi, first of all, let's see what the troll had to say.
Okay,
here's the troll. And please give the handle of the troll. It's very important that we know exactly.
Okay.
At athletes rule.
Okay, at athletes rule has to say hormonal birth control causes cancer and isn't effective.
Oh, yay! You know what? This is one of my favorite ones that they say. This has been the new battle cry about hormonal birth control. And I often like to say back to them, and if you'd like to join in, I'm sure that he writes many, many tomes about the tobacco industry and how horrible the tobacco industry is and that they cause cancer and that we should immediately get rid of all tobacco and that it's not effective. So turns out hormonal birth control possibly might be effective or else we'd have bazillions of children. So I'm going to go with wrong.
Wrong.
And we just started our pledges and we are at a whopping $115, people. Yes, $115. But we get up that. It's early, we're on, it's happening. That's right, $115. What do we do after the vulva? I don't have my rundown. Somebody tell me. Oh my God, this is so great. My dear friend, Amy Hagstrom Miller, who owns the whole women's health clinics in Texas, in Maryland, and Minnesota, is hosting a party tonight at the clinic. They're watching live. You're gonna see the Texas video, and then we are going to get a tour of Amy's clinic, because Amy's clinic, her flagship clinic, will be closing at the end of July, thanks to these Texas laws. So we're gonna move these mics. We're gonna just move the mics over, you guys, and then you can roll the video.
Dreams, past bullshit schemes make laws clinics can't abide. We fought in vain, now six remain, access sure to be denied. Don't you ever say you take my rights away, 'cause you care about me. Gun rights glorified, equal pay denied, 'cause you care about me. GOP is like a wrecking ball. Women never hit so hard before. All they wanted was to probe my walls. All they ever did is wreck me. Yeah, you wreck me.
It's all about doing good, you know, in the world and helping each other. And
we save lives every day.
It's now taken away for no real logical reason whatsoever.
We won't be here come September. It has nothing to do with what women need. It has all to do with what the state has been able to push through in the Capitol and making women's lives more difficult.
Hi, I'm Amy Hagstrom Miller, and I am the founder of Whole Women's Health. And I'm standing outside here right in Austin, Texas, where our company got started, and this is our first flagship clinic. And sadly, this is the beautiful facility that's going to have to close because of HB2 and the crazy laws that have passed here in Texas. And so one of the things I wanted to do today was invite you in the door of our clinic and walk you through the facility and talk to some of the staff and talk a little bit about what it is, the work that we do here, and let you kind of see inside and meet some of our team.
Can we help you?
Hey, it's Amy.
Come on in, man.
So come on in the front door, and these are the first people that a patient would see when she comes in the front door. And part of what we do at Whole Women's Health is we really focus on, you know, meeting the woman where she's at, trying to help her feel as comfortable as possible, and really combat the shame and stigma that women feel around reproductive health and specifically abortion. We have these fabulous women who meet people eye to eye, and they don't know what to expect when they walk in the door. They don't know who's going to be here, so they're just absolutely nervous walking in the door. But making that direct eye contact from the beginning, greeting them, giving them the opportunity to calm down if they need to. One of the things we do is we name all of our rooms after different women, so you don't have like the waiting room in the front desk. You've got here Frida Kahlo. You've got our other waiting room is named after Aretha Franklin. So part of what we're doing here is trying to welcome women and put them into a continuum of the thousands of women around the world and throughout time that have been in their shoes and that have shared the experience that they're having with us here at Whole Women's Health of Austin. So I'm just going to walk you through like the normal course of what a patient would go through in her day with us. Of course, we're going to do it a little faster. The first step is usually lab. You come into the laboratory and you see our staff person, Rebecca, here, and we do blood pressure, temperature, pulse. We check the person's blood type, that kind of thing, in the lab area. This is a ultrasound room. You can come on in here. This room is named after Indira Gandhi. And this is where we do the ultrasound for the woman, and it's oftentimes a pretty intense process for her. So it used to be that ultrasound was the time when we really had a connection with the woman, and it could be determined by what the woman needed and wanted to talk about. And now, since so many laws have passed in Texas, there's all these mandated things we're required to do in ultrasound. Like, we have to do the ultrasound, then what we have to describe the image to the woman, whether she wanted it or not. Whereas before, Whole Women's Health always offered to every woman, would you like to see your ultrasound? And it was done more in a patient-centered, woman-centered way. And now we have these scripts we're mandated to read, the doctor's mandated to do all these different things, and it's sort of changed that sort of dynamic.
We involve the woman. We let her dictate how the experience is going to go, what kind of experience she wants to have, and what's important for her, what's going to matter most to her during her time with us. And even though we have to comply with all these regulations and all this information has to be given, we want to give her the opportunity to tell us what's going to make it more comfortable for her.
Most of the time after ultrasound, a patient either goes into counseling or goes to what we call intake, which is sort of a demographic, financial, medical history kind of information exchange. One of the things at Whole Women's Health that's really something we're really known for is our one-on-one private counseling session that we offer with women. things they may be scared about, either related to abortion or related to sexuality or related to whatever's going on in their life. It's not a therapy session, but it's a time when people can ask questions, they can confront stereotypes that they've been told, and we can have an exchange that invites a woman not to feel so alone and invites her to see herself as part of a group of women who have experienced unplanned pregnancy in their lifetime and try to shed some of that shame and stigma. So here we're encountering Marva again. Marva is one of our most seasoned staff people here at Whole Woman's Health. She's a huge advocate and has really moved all around Texas, helping us keep our clinics open as long as we can. Marva was in Beaumont, then she was in Fort Worth, and we had to close the Beaumont office, and now she's relocated down to San Antonio, which is the one office that is an ambulatory surgical center that we're going to be able to keep open in Texas, no matter what the laws are here.
I think this room is the room. This is the room where the women are the most comfortable. They've gotten to know us a little bit. They've been through a couple of steps. They've met the staff. They've noticed the flow of the session. A lot of times in this room, one of two things happen. Either we totally deconstruct and rebuild, or we learn that that woman has already dealt with this with her family and her loved ones, and she's ready to move forward. So this room is definitely meeting the woman where she is, letting her tell us what she needs from us, and then giving that and fulfilling that for her. Since HB2, we've heard a lot of concern or complaint even about the move and the running back and forth on the highway, patients having to drive very long ways. Not only that, having to wait a little while to get into clinics now because there are clinics closing. The clinics that are open, the schedules are really bulked up, so patients are having to wait a while sometimes to get into the clinics. And we're hearing that more often from HB2.
Had a patient who actually, and her husband, her whole family actually drove their RV from Fort Worth because they couldn't get an appointment soon enough, all the way down here to Austin, and spent 2 days basically sleeping out in our parking lot in order to have the abortion at a time when worked for their family and worked for their work schedule. We also had a patient who worked in a casino in Lake Charles, Louisiana, and worked until 2 a.m. when her shift ended, drove all night to come here, paid for her abortion in ones and fives, brought her whole family, including her kids, here, had their abortion here in Austin, and then drove all night again for them to be able to work the shift that she had to work again in the casino the next day. So this is the kind of stuff that we're already seeing, right, with HB2.
Yes, and unfortunately, we predict that it will get worse, because now there will be even more clinics that will close and even less access to the service that the women need. It's the women that we see right here in this room. This room, counseling, well, it's what decides whether you love abortion care or you don't, because you hear the stories and you hear what women are going through and why those women are here. And we save lives. We save lives every day. I can't tell you how many countless times I've had a woman hug me and say, "I don't know what I would do if you were not here today." The end of the day, abortion saves lives, and we're saving lives every day.
So after counseling, most of the women would either go to intake to make their payment, do some medical history, get pharmaceutical meds, they may get birth control pills, they may talk about the contraception that was discussed here in the counseling room. They're probably going to go and talk about an IUD, or they may get a depo shot. So it's sort of like the financial exchange and the medical history kind of exchange that happens at intake. In this room, we prepared an in-house movie at Whole Woman's Health that kind of walks women through what to expect on the day of the procedure, and it's filmed with our staff in our building. We do this as a group. We have boyfriends, husbands, mothers, girlfriends, and the women who are patients all in here watching the film together, you know, a couple groups at a time. And there's a lot of connection that happens between those groups of people where they talk, and there's sort of a destigmatization and a comforting peer-to-peer that will happen in this room when people are watching the film. And in here you see Miss Rebecca, and this is our procedure room named after Margaret Cho. And this is our largest procedure room, where sometimes we will not only provide abortions in this room, but we do colposcopies and other things, treatment of abnormal pap smears, and other gynecological procedures are done in this room. And, you know, really simply, what happens when a woman has an abortion?
Well, it's really similar to when she gets a pelvic exam and a pap smear. The initial part of it is not like that. The exam table is a very familiar place for women who have been in a gynecological office. And then over here are, this is a packet of sterile instruments that we use during the abortion procedure, speculum, gloves. But oftentimes women are very nervous, and so when we come into this setting, we try to make it as comfortable for them as possible. The low lighting, the color of the walls, Everything is set around helping her to relax and feel comfortable, including if she wants to see the equipment and the machines and everything before being seen that day for her procedure. We have no problem with that because that can help kind of reduce anxiety, help her feel a little more control and understanding of what kind of environment she's going to be in.
So how long does the abortion take, like from when the doctor inserts the speculum until the abortion is done?
It generally takes about 5 minutes, sometimes 10 minutes, depending, you know, if some people are easier to have their cervix dilated than others, or if they're kind of nervous, we may take a little more time inserting a speculum or that kind of thing. So it's a very fast procedure, especially when someone has sedation, when they have nitrous gas, or when they're, you know, having medication help them relax, that time goes by pretty quickly.
You know, some women choose that, some women need it, some women don't need it, and it kind of fits in with our philosophy about, you know, women should be as comfortable as possible, and for some women, you know, more meds are needed, and for other women, they're like, I'm fine, give me a local, I'm out of here, I gotta go back to work.
I found that this work has been very fulfilling, being able to work alongside women at a time when they need support, when they need love, when they need information, when they need to feel empowered about what's happening with their bodies, and that's something that we're able to do here, and not all clinics do that.
I gotta tell you, Rebecca was here on the very first day Whole Women's Health opened, on the first day we saw patients here in Austin, when I thought we'd have like 3 or 4 patients, and we had 19, and I had to call Rebecca out of bed to come and help me counsel all the patients. So that was 11 years ago, and now Rebecca is in medical school, and she's doing some fabulous things to make the world a better place for women. So after the procedure, most women, you know, just walk themselves to the recovery room. They don't need a stretcher. They don't need an ambulatory surgical center. They don't need general anesthesia. They can just actually walk down the hall, and they go into what we call an aftercare room, which is right down the hall. Here you'll see the recliners. This room here at Whole Women's Health is named after George O'Keefe. And this is where the women come post-procedure. And they hang out here in the recovery room. Some of them have had sedation, others have not had sedation. Here's where we monitor their vital signs.
This is actually one of my favorite rooms because it's the end of the visit. You know, when the patient first comes in, there's a lot of fear, there's a lot of concerns, and as they go through the process with us, you know, lots of those get answered by meeting our staff and talking about what's important to them. And then once they get here, you know, they've had the procedure. A lot of times their loved ones are with them here.
So you see the men and the moms and the girlfriends really involved in learning the aftercare instructions. How can I help her? And thank you so much for your care and that kind of thing. There's like a reuniting that happens that's oftentimes really powerful to watch.
Yeah.
When I was walking down the hall, I made a reference to the ambulatory surgical center that we're required to have in Texas from September on. And I can't even begin to describe to you how different that environment is from this private, you know, doctor's office clinic based setting. Not only the hallway widths and the size of the operating rooms and the operating lights and the air conditioning system that makes it cold, and we can't have fleece blankets that are warm and fuzzy, we can't give people you know, warm tea in the recovery room, and you know, to me it really sits down in this room. The recovery room in the ambulatory surgical center is so different from this. It's not this sort of warm, comfortable feeling. There, people are on stretchers, they're divided by curtains, it's really sort of medical, there's machines beeping and buzzing all the time, and really changes women's experience. And that's one of the things I think a lot of us feel a lot of grief about, because it has nothing to do with medical safety, it has nothing to do with what women need, it has all to do with what the state has been able to push through in the Capitol and making women's lives more difficult. And seeing these clinics that we have built and that we have grown the staff and have grown the physical plants, we have to close the doors here and walk away from this model of care in Texas and figure out how we're going to have this intimacy and have this connection with women in a mini hospital setting.
I mean, it's pretty devastating. It's been hard. We've currently closed 2 clinics, on the verge of closing 2 more. So it's an impossible thing to deal with.
It's heartbreaking because it's been over a decade of fabulous abortion care, nothing but offering a community service.
We've got some really dedicated, fabulous people spread all throughout the state here. And we have a lot of grief for what women are going to have to go through in this state, both to access care and also to get the quality of care that doesn't just treat their uterus, but that treats their whole body and their spirit to the extent that we do here at Whole Women's Health.
Amy is a really wonderful woman. She's a Minnesota woman. And that video, to me, was incredibly powerful. It was very hard to edit because it was 26 minutes long, and every moment of the video was brilliant. And we couldn't show you a 26-minute video, but that's what's happening every day in every single state except Oregon. And so I just want to, they're watching right now live, so I just want to give them a gigantic round of applause. Yeah. Hi, Amy. Hi, everybody. They have 50 women in their clinic watching. They're giant supporters. And thank you guys for doing that. It's you put a face on it. You tell your story. They can't marginalize you and make you a statistic. They have to recognize you for being a human being. And I think it's really one of the things that we want to do here is just to remind people that women exist and women have abortions. Things don't have abortions. Statistics don't have abortions. People have abortions. And they need to have them, because in the history of forever, people get pregnant when they can't afford it, can't do it, it will kill them. So thank you for being here and keeping the fight, and we're going to keep it going. We have a couple more wonderful things to show you, and I want to bring up a guy who, he's a dear friend of mine. He is one of the sponsors of this event from Blue Nation Review, an incredible website. If you haven't read it, it's amazing, and I don't say that because they hired me, but they hired me. I'm not really the amazing part. I'm just the like, hey, let's get Liz because she's crazy and we'll get a bunch of traffic from her nuttiness. But he's an incredible journalist. He's an incredible supporter. He's an incredible man who understands how important it is to fight for reproductive justice and justice in general. He's a gay man who fights the fight and walks the walk for everybody, women and everybody. So I love him to death. So please welcome the executive director of Blue Nation Review, Mr. Jimmy Williams. And his super gay pants. I'm just going to say it. His pants are really gay.
I wore them just for you, baby.
Those are so gay. Is there gayer pants?
$5. $5. I paid good. $5 for these pants. $5.
I just have to say, the reason I said his pants are super gay is that he wrote in the intro, which I didn't read, I'm as gay as a mouse? I don't know what that means.
I don't either.
That's why I didn't say it.
I don't know what it means.
Okay, take it away, my friend.
I love
you. Give us 3 minutes of gold.
Oh, I can't do that. Thank you, Lizz Winstead. Thank you. You rock. Thank you. This is irritating, and I'm gay, and I don't like phallic symbols. This is very irritating. So I'm just going to take it off because that's easier. Thank you for being here. This means a lot. On behalf of BlueNationReview.com, my staff and my colleagues and my friends, and on behalf of Lizz Winstead, you rock for being here. You rock for live streaming. You rock for watching wherever the hell you are, in Texas and Louisiana and all across the country. This matters. I grew up in South Carolina. I was a Republican. I was engaged to a chick. Yeah, so you keep, because there's more. There's more. I went to the Citadel. We started the Civil War. Not while I was there. I'm not that fucking old. But we started the Civil War. And we've done all kinds of things that are not so great for, well, the world. And so, but the point is that you sort of own that shit, and then you live your life. And you realize that it's not just about you. It's not about me just being a little sissy from South Carolina. It's about being a part of America. And I could have lived that lie. I could have lived in the closet. I could have gotten married, almost did. I could have had kids. I could have done lots of things. But I chose to actually be honest with myself. And why? Well, because that's what you do in America. You just have to be honest with yourself. These men and women in these states that run around saying vaginal probes and ultrasound and this sort of thing, they're not being honest with themselves, because mostly they're men, and not a single one of them has ever squeezed 9 pounds out of their assholes. So I'm not sure exactly why they're having, yes, please clap to that, for God's sakes. So men in America, squeeze 9 pounds out of your butt, and you can have a conversation about choice, and until that time, shut the fuck up, because we don't care what you think. We don't, and I'm a man. And thank God, as a gay man, because if I got knocked up, I would want that choice. I would. Because that would be my right. That would be my privacy. We talk about choice and we talk about all sorts of things with our bodies, but at the end of the day, the Constitution's clear. It's about our privacy, isn't it? It's about what we want to have private. We go into our homes. I have something called the pajama test. The government should not be anywhere where you can wear pajamas, ever. Ever, period, no matter what. If you're wearing your pajamas, and by the way, I sleep naked, but if I were wearing my pajamas, the government shouldn't be in my home, nor in yours, because it's your privacy. We talk about the NSA, but we don't have a conversation about the contraception, the privacy of our contraception, the privacy of our sex, the privacy of whom we have sex with or who we have sex with. That's our choice. Yes, we choose to have sex. We do. I embrace that. I fuck a lot. Raise your hand if you fuck a lot. If you don't, you should fuck more. But my point is that it's about our privacy. And what Lizz and her team are doing is simple. It's about your privacy in your home, in your office, in your car, wherever you want to be. It's about your privacy. And so I have the beauty and the honor of doing two different things in my life. Well, I do lots of things. But for work, professionally, I get to go on TV and defend progressivism. Why? Because I believe in it. I believe in progressivism. And then I get to also be the editor of a website called BlueNationReview.com. We're about progressivism, and we're not afraid of it. We embrace it. We want it, and we're going to push it down your throat, conservative America, if you fucking like it or not. That's what we're going to do. And why? Because we're in the majority. We're in the majority. Every time someone gets up in a state legislature and they talk about states' rights, Chris Christie talks about states' rights. The governor in the state next door to us talks about states' rights. And what does he say? He says, I'm against gay marriage. By the way, gay marriage is legal in New Jersey. And he admits that it's legal in New Jersey, but he just 2 days ago, he said, I think the Republicans, this is Chris Christie speaking, I think the Republicans should use this in states where it matters, where it'll hurt Democrats in the fall. That's states' rights. Contraception, apparently, is states' rights. Clinics, health care is states' rights. That's wrong. That's wrong. When those white dudes with white wigs and slaves said equal justice under the law, they weren't talking about everybody, but today we're talking about everybody, everybody in this room. There's a lot of different colors in this room. There's a lot of different people in this room. Because we live in America, not in a state, not in New York or New Jersey or South Carolina, but we live in America. And so it is equal justice and law for everybody. So when a conservative stands up and they say states' rights, or they say vaginal probes in Texas, the answer is no. You don't have that right. You don't get that right. And you're in the minority. And that's what Lizz Winstead is doing. That's what we're going to do at Blue Nation Review. We're going to beat the living shit out of these people. Every single day. We're going to beat the shit out of these people. We're going to make them suffer. We're going to make them hurt. We're going to call them out. We're going to call them ass cactuses, ass hats. You name it. We're going to call it. We're going to back it up. We're going to do video. Chris Christie said his thing. I did a video yesterday. I said, Chris Christie, you're a dick. And it was like a 5-second video. Sarah Burris, my digital editor, who's my friend, she videoed it and it took 5 seconds. But it said, Chris Christie, you're a dick. And by the way, Chris Christie's a dick. And I like dick, and he's not the kind of dick I like. So here's how it works, folks. You got to speak up. You got to be angry. And you got to be, the same amount of time that you're angry, you got to be happy. Because otherwise, we're just angry progressives. And I like happy progressives. I like angry and happy. I like bipolar progressives, I guess. Right? There's nothing wrong with being a little bit bipolar, trust me. So thank you. Thank you, Lizz Winstead, and everything that you're doing. Go to BlueNationReview.com. Go, if you want to send shit to us, send shit to us. We got a website, blah, blah, blah. But the bottom line is speak up, speak out, speak loud, and don't stop speaking. If you stop speaking, they win, and we're in the majority. Thank you.
That is awesome. We're going to get a quick vulva update, and then we're going to go to our friends in California who have hi, vulva. Oh, the poor vulva stuck. You know, the vulva's made it. All right. First off, let's hear the fun, the troll.
Okay, we have a troll. And it's TX Rowdy 10 Ron. All the other handles were taken, I guess. Disgusting. Women celebrating murder of unborn children.
Where is that happening? We should stop that. If that is happening somewhere, I would like to know where that is, and I would like to reconvene this party to where that is happening, because I think we would all agree that we would like to have that not happen. No one is for that. Ron, you are mistaken. You should probably turn into another. That's terrible. And we have a donation update, and I'm going to add to it. $795, and we have somebody just wrote me and said I just made a $500 donation on PayPal, so we have that also, so that is coming in as well. So yes, donations are coming in. Thank you so much. Thank you for donating. It's so nice. And if you want these T-shirts, they're kind of fun. You can get them at Teespring. It's this amazing crowds. What is it called when you do a thing like Kickstarter, whatever that's called? I don't know. Begging. I think it's called begging. Begging. But they have them and they're great, and they actually are T-shirts that if you do use sourcing, they actually give you a little bit of money instead of not. So that's great. So Volvo, we'll see you in a minute. We have a great group of folks in California who have helped us along the way. You're going to meet some of the LA or the New York folks a little bit later when I close out. But some of the LA folks in the team got together and made a little video just to kind of talk about LA, the LA-based writing community that we have formed out there, and also about another initiative that I'll go into a little bit further called V to Shining V, as a celebration of access and kind of getting people riled up for the elections on September 27th. So we're going to show you a little bit from the California family, starting out with our California video and then the California kids.
Hey, New York, thanks so much for streaming us in. We are your comedian team out here in LA, the Lady Parts Justice Los Angeles.
Hey. Oh, my name is Dio, and I'm on the project because I love Liz and I love vaginas, and I believe that women and transgender people should have access to reproductive health care.
Yeah. I'm Jenny Yang, and I'm a comic, and I'm involved with Lady Parts Justice because I love Liz too. And because I just believe in healthcare for all of us and not using Asians as some weird reason for, like, I don't know, not giving us healthcare or trans folks or women and bait, I don't know.
Using anything.
Yeah. We need to get our healthcare.
Holler.
Hi, I'm Helen Hong. I'm a stand-up comedian and actress. I am so excited to be part of Lady Parts Justice because I think that I should be in charge of my own damn body. And I don't really want anybody to tell me what I can and cannot do with it. And
I believe everyone should be educated. You should know how everything works. You should know how to get access to everything. Access should be cheaper. You should be able to get condoms. Kids should be able to get condoms if they need them. And please stop telling me what I can do with my body because it's mine. I grew it myself.
Yes.
All right, and I'm Liana. I'm so happy to be here for so many reasons. I'm from Virginia, and I've just seen over and over again how religion is used to wage wars against women and control women, and at some point we've got to step up, have responsible dialogue, and I'm honored to be a part of this project because Liz is bringing responsibility to the forefront, as well as laughter, and you can't get any better than that. There's a quote that I love, and it says, what does it say? It says, if you're going to tell the truth, you better make them laugh, and she's fucking making people laugh.
So yeah.
So what's next? How can you get involved at home?
September 27th, V to Shining V. That's the day we're all going to host house parties, tell everyone we know about what the heck is going on in our states, about reproductive health, reproductive justice. We're going to make it fun. We're here in LA. We're going to have a show.
Yeah. Comedy show.
It's going to be super fun. Go on the website, register. There's also going to be fun rallies, surprise celebrity guests. You don't know who's going to show up, so you guys should definitely go on the website, check it out, register your own house party so that people know where they can go to get informed on the issues.
Yeah. This is just the beginning, guys. Thanks for having us, New York.
Yay! Yay!
Hey, New York, thanks so much for streaming us in. We are your comedian team out here in LA, the Lady Parts Justice Los Angeles.
In Sri Lanka, a woman can't get access to birth control if her husband forbids it. I hope things get better in the future. In America, trans men can't access birth control if their doctors deny it. I hope things get better in the future.
This message brought to you by LadyPartsJustice.com, kicking politicians out of vaginas since 2012. Justice.com, kicking politicians out of vaginas since 2012.
I love technology. I'm super good at it. Thank you to the people in LA. Have a hand for some of the folks there. Quickly, the marching orders are, we have a website up when we're done, which we have a couple more things happening, and then poke around on it. See what you like, see what you don't like. Let us know. I'm sure you will. I can already tell we're going to get a lot of really nice comments. But see what it's about. But the one thing we want to do is as we launch and people start learning about what's happening in their states, we want to push for people to start planning and plotting for September 27th to have house parties, block parties, to get together with friends and educate them on what's happening in a way where you have beer and food and a cookout and music. Do it at a bar. Do it at your house. Get your neighbors to, you know, block off the street. But do it so you talk about what's at stake in your state, figure out who these local politicians are, what's on your ballot, so you can actually engage people to vote in the midterms. I don't know about you, but I get incredibly sick of hearing media people blabbing that no one ever turns out in the midterms. The midterms are stupid. No one's ever going to turn out anyway. They just predict the inevitable, and I refuse to take it sitting down. 10 more million women than men voted in the last election. I think that we can all get together and drink and eat and plot and scheme to make sure they turn out again. It's not that hard. It's just adding like something of substance in your drinking habits. Seriously, can we do at least that? I think we can. Yes, I know, it's great. And so people are celebrating and doing these September 27th events in many ways. And one of the events is going to be in Madison, Wisconsin, and we are really lucky enough to have a woman who is planning the Madison event, so she's going to tell you what she's doing and how, if this sounds interesting to you, you can sort of take in this whole teach-in situation on September 27th. So, without further ado, we have an amazing photographer and activist, originally from Austin, Texas, now living in Madison. She just stepped down as the president of the Madison chapter of NOW, and she is here to talk to you about V to Shining V and what's happening in Madison on September 27th. Please welcome Wendy Kent. Wendy! Knock him dead, girl.
Hi. Holy shit, I'm really nervous, okay. I think I'm the only person that doesn't do this like regularly. So that's me, what she said, and where I'm from and stuff. And I created this thing called the Abortion Truth Project and the Abortion Truth Teach-In and abortiontruthproject.com. You can go there to find out about it. I'm going to tell you. But so I was really excited. We organized this. I'm super stoked that the Madison chapter of the National Organization for Women is going to be the very first host of this teach-in. And this is a new approach. This is something that I really want picked up across the country. I'm really tired of seeing our super talented resources being used entirely to try to make our majority, as Jimmy Williams greatly pointed out already, us the majority, a bigger majority. 7 out of 10, we all know this number, I think. We are the majority. We aren't losing because there aren't enough of us. We are losing because there aren't enough of us speaking out. And the key to empowering people to speak out is educating them. So we are hosting a teach-in. We are going to have an abortion provider there to explain in layman's terms to participants what is involved in abortion procedures. She's going to dispel any myths or misconceptions. She's going to answer questions. We're going to have an amazing panel full of experts. And it's basically all about empowering our base, because we do not do that efficiently and effectively at the moment. We are too worried about trying to bring others who are against us right now to our side. We don't need to do that. We're the majority. We need to stop that. We can maybe do that a little bit over here, but we need to talk more to our own people. They talk to their people all the time. Particularly once a week on Sundays, if you know what I'm saying. We don't have that. We don't have that gathering place. We need that, and we need to figure out where to do that. Beat a Shining V-Day is one of those places. I'm excited to help host this teach-in. Madison Now is going to be leading the way with that. If your organization wants to host an abortion truth teach-in, we will provide a toolkit for you. You contact me, and I will help you do this. Otherwise, on Vita Shining V Day, get creative and, you know, do what you know is true. Educate your brothers and sisters on this issue. Empower them with that knowledge. You wouldn't believe how many people who identify as choice activists or advocates don't know the most basic statistics, and they actually feel like they're part of the minority. We need to change that. That's why they're not speaking out. So education is the key. We need to empower them. I invite everybody to ask me questions about this when we're finished. I'm really excited to be a part of this, and I can't wait to see what this entire day of like extreme education and empowerment is gonna be like. We're gonna host the teach-in all day long, and then we're gonna go straight to the Madison Capitol, which is, you may have seen in the news a little bit. And then we're going to have a giant after party, and I encourage everybody to do a little bit of the same wherever you all are. Thank you.
Today on LPJ.
Where to even begin with Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker? I mean, this is not a smart dude.
On choice, on abortion, with Paul Ryan. Do you share his views?
That's a ridiculous question, because nobody I talk to in Wisconsin, or else across the country, talks about that.
Women's reproductive rights is a ridiculous question?
It is.
He professionally pisses off women.
I mean, he passed a law that allows any pharma douche to decide whether a woman can get a birth control pill or not.
Can they deny a guy boner pills?
Nope.
Well, what are the good of boner pills if my girlfriend can't get birth control, right?
Yeah, now Scott Walker is pissing me off.
It gets better. He also passed a law that forces teachers to teach abstinence alongside sex ed.
How do you even teach abstinence?
Right? And who wants to teach a guy to be good and not fucking me?
Oh, and don't forget, he passed that vaginal probe law.
Passed? You mean shoved into law over 4th of July weekend?
We shoved into some vaginals over the 4th of July weekend.
Do you even know what a vaginal probe is? It's this huge hammerhead camera dildo that Scott Walker wants to ram jam up a woman so we make her look at her own uterus.
Hot!
I feel like organ porn.
So much for Independence Day for vaginas.
Oh, guys, hold up. That's not even the latest on Walker. He's being probed into his sketchy campaign finance deals.
Probe some sketchy deals.
On the guy who beat cancer.
Oh, David Brett. He's a teabagger.
Of course.
Hot.
This message brought to you by LadyPartsJustice.com, kicking politicians out of vaginas since 2012.
Woo!
real DIY, you guys. Mics just go everywhere.
Oh,
you guys all right? Okay, you're so sweet. No, you need a vocal mic though, don't
guys,
you?
I'll just use that.
Okay.
Right?
All right. All right. Are you guys okay?
You like that?
We're all right. We're gonna be okay.
That's
all right.
All right. Okay. This is my friend Holly Miranda.
This is Ambrosia Parsley. Right?
Yes.
That's your note.
Make me laugh when it's goodbye with the bill and the body count so high. We're out of breath. The water's red. It's a lousy photograph. So make me laugh.
Can you guys hear this? A little bit.
Make me laugh. Keep your lullaby. Who can sleep underneath a falling sky? The petrified, the bitter bride, don't they need a paragraph to make them laugh? Not a face without sorrow's autograph. But what could chase the tears and the lace away like a funny epitaph? Make me laugh if birds shot lose their song. If the sweet honeybees get up and gone through record highs when oceans rise. What you call them mean high with a laugh?
Oh, hey, Eunice. Nice to see you. Oh, you are so cute, Eunice.
How you feeling?
Well, I love all the people here.
Wow. You've had a pretty rough month, babe.
It's been hard. I know it's hard.
Yeah.
You need a mic, Eunice.
I need a mic.
You do need a mic.
I know.
What were you thinking?
I was thinking that I'm a puppet and I've been drinking. I was celebrating with everyone and I forgot a mic. That's right.
Hey, Eunice, remember when I used to sing the news?
I loved it when you sang the news.
Do you remember that?
Yes.
Well, me and Holly.
With those radicals.
Me and Holly decided that we would sing the news for you tonight as a special treat.
For me?
Just for you.
Oh, dear Lord.
And you guys have to help. we're going to sing a fancy intro. And then after that happens, if you could help Snap to keep some time.
Whoa. Come on. You can snap. Do you have fingers?
Hey, Eunice, can you snap
those
things?
I know you all have fingers. I know all you lesbians have fingers. To snap with
okay,
us.
Well, just do what I say, okay? For once, please. Ready?
We've all been drinking for a while.
We just, it's fresh. It's fucking fresh. It's just for you. Okay, hold on. All right, just in case. Mm-hmm.
They're throwing darts and breaking hearts, but Eunice don't dismay. Our lady parts are here to save the day. Snap with us, ladies and gentlemen.
Did you know in 17 states they make you see a counselor?
While 87% of counties are without a provider.
And 13 states your pharmacist could show your ass the door.
What you gonna do? No pills for you, you nasty, filthy, dirty whore. Did you know the pumps for boys to bring them joy get green lights all the way?
But lady parts who need safe starts will need their boss to say okay.
And if you lack freedom and respect, then when we must insist
that you're not just a cunt,
but a Yankee Doodle feminist.
I tried.
All right, thank you so much. Before we go, I just want to bring up all of the people who have made this possible. If you have worked on this, please come up. I just want to show people how many people are in. Please come up. Amber Gavin, our national coordinator. Amy Kirsten, our senior producer. Katie Kablushis, our director of social media. Arun Chaudhry, my partner. Sarah Stubby Clicker, my partner. Oh my God, Jessica Pimentel from Orange is the New Black is coming up here right now.
Katie.
Claude, where is Claude? Darby Worley, the voice of Air America. Here is Claude, our DP.
Eunice
is here. A hand for the booth up there. Eric, who has been amazing. Scott Goodstein, who is not here tonight. And I just have to say this name out loud because she is not here and she should be. Eden Joyner, who is Eden, who is in D.C. making sure that this website got up. I don't even know if this is broadcast at all, quite frankly. Do we have a website? Who knows? It's a mystery. There are so many writers that are here. Joelle is here. Mindy Tucker taking pictures. There's a team of rotating people here in New York that is about 33 men and women who meet at my house on Sunday nights and we cook dinner and we collaborate. In LA, we have about the same number. Folks in DC, and it is an incredible group of people. And it's time that we reset things in a different way. We can't do this by ourselves. We can't do this for free. So if you think this is a worthy endeavor, please donate. We're not asking because we think it's something, some folly. It's fucking real. And it really needs to, and I have a uterus on the outside of my shirt right now, and a vulva. There's a lot of fabric parts that are all over the place. So thank you for coming. Thank you for watching again to Texas, Louisiana, to the women and men who need reproductive health care all over the country. We're with you. We're fighting with you. Thank you for coming. Check out the website. September 27th. Get your fucking party on. We're going to take it back. Thanks. Good night, everybody. Oh, what about the babies? Oh, yeah. What about the babies? There are no babies. Stop talking about the babies. No one's killing babies. Last time checked, it's against the law, so shut the fuck up about it. $1,695 plus $500. Thank you. Oh, the raffle, raffle. Don't leave. There's the raffle. Oh, the, a live stream can leave. Oh, no, the live stream can leave, but don't go because we have a raffle. So we'll do the raffle. And we're going to have Jessica. Where's Jess?
She's right here.
Jess. I'll get the thing. Jessica, everybody, our lovely woman who has taken your money and your raffle tickets. Will you be the puller of tickets?
I will pull anything you want.
You will? She's going to pull anything I want. So don't go. Raffling. We're raffling. Darby, what are you doing? All right. Here we go. So... I guess
the list of prizes.
I'm just gonna give the list of prizes one by one. Okay, we'll just start with this one. Can somebody take Eunice? I feel she's abused. Or do you want to keep her up? Or we just have someone hold. Oh, here, this is odd. I'm sure that is some kind of scientific impossibility or a fetish. One of the two. Oh, that does work somehow. That's amazing. All right, so the first thing we're gonna raffle off is. This is this gift right here.
Oh, from the lovely Alaskan lady.
So, one of the things that we do in our videos is that we desperately try to have a woman from the state that we represent in our videos. And one of the women in the Alaska videos is actually a Native Alaskan. She's from an Eskimo tribe. And she and her three sisters, who are triplets, they were here tonight, had this beautiful skincare line where they actually are trying to keep these lines in Alaska, and they harvest things in the town that they grew up in. It's incredible. So the first thing is this from them. It is called, I can't even pronounce, how do you say that?
Arsotica.
Arsotica, thank you, you're very good.
Thank you.
All right, so winner of the Arsotica package is?
I'm not looking.
You're not looking?
Your number is 340-2024. Well, that was a letdown.
Are you here?